HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Hazel's Theory of Evolution by Lisa Jenn Bigelow, performed by Kathleen McInerney. Chapter 1. Mom said to think positive because the first face I saw at Finley might belong to my first new friend. I don't think she was accounting for the giant bronze fish statue on the lawn. The bus stopped right in front of it. I almost lost an eye on its harpoon. I figured it was a brook trout, Michigan state fish. It looked dim-witted, the kind of fish that swam wherever the current took it, never wondering what lay past the next bend, never suspecting its life could change in a splash, until a heron's beak broke the surface and skewered it like a marshmallow. At which point, of course, it was too late. Not that this was its fault, it was who it was. But at that moment, I hated that fish. It was stuck staring at a swarm of pimply kids for all eternity and didn't even seem to mind. The plaque at its base said Finley Middle School, home of the fighting fish. Yeah, right. I wished I could take a selfie with it and send it to Mom. Here's me and my new bestie. The truth was, I wasn't planning to make friends at Finley. First, because if the past 8 years were any indication, the probability was low, so why waste my energy? Second, because I didn't need more friends. I had Becca. Sure, she was at my old school, but since there was only one high school in our county, all I had to do was make it through the year and we'd be together again. It was too bad humans couldn't hibernate. I'd hug myself like a bat slumbering through the coldest, darkest days of winter, a do not disturb sign hanging at the entrance of my cozy cave. Instead, my plan for this year was to do my best imitation. I'd function at the most basic level, going to class, doing my homework. But as far as other people were concerned, I'd be deep asleep. Then, come next summer, I'd awake, refreshed, stretch my wings, and fly to high school as if eighth grade had never happened. Right now, I felt anything but refreshed. The bus ride had left me as sticky as a caramel oozing in someone's pocket, collecting lint. My hair frizzed around my face, where my elastic didn't quite hold it back. My glasses steamed. I'd worn a button-down shirt and jeans because Mom said they made me look grown up. But I wished I'd gone with my gut and worn my usual t-shirt and cutoffs. I hiked up my backpack and let the stream of kids wash me into the brick building. School was a half day, so the teachers had barely enough time to introduce themselves, take roll, and go over our plan for the fall. That's what they always called it, our plan for the fall, even though syllabus would have been more efficient and precise, before the next bell rang. Some kids seemed to notice I was new, but when I didn't make eye contact, they lost interest. I trudged from class to class, sat quietly at my desk, and kept an eye on the clock. In other words, everything was going according to my own plan for the fall, until my last class. The first problem was getting there. My schedule said it was in room T4, but I spent all of passing period without finding it or any other room labeled with T. The bell rang before I finally found it at the end of a long hallway in the basement, past the cafeteria, along with the wood shop, art studio, and family and consumer science room with its rows of kitchenettes and sewing machines. Apparently, T stood for technology. Maybe Finley's idea of health and human development involved brain implants and robotic limbs. My brother Rowan would love that. I slid into the room, and for the first time all morning, everyone's eyes fell on me. the class was perched on stools around tall black tables that looked like cast-offs from a chemistry lab. And judging by the scorch marks and stains, they were. The exception was a low table along the side, where one boy sat alone. He stood out from everyone else for another reason, too, his neon green mohawk. He noticed me noticing him, and his dark eyes narrowed. The teacher, who looked like a tiny gray sparrow in a pantsuit, came to the door. I wondered if she'd hand me a tardy slip, but she said only, "Hello, what's your name?" "Hazel Brownlee Wellington." She consulted her roster. "There you are. Except my list says Hazel Brownlee Welly. Guess it was too much for the computer to handle." She smiled. I didn't. Teachers had been making some variation on the comment all morning. "I'm Mrs. Paradisi," she said. "We've got a chair for you next to Yoshi. Excuse me, Yosh Fukuzawa. Consider that your seat for the semester." I didn't need her to tell me who Yosh was. The only seat left was a folding chair beside the boy with the green mohawk. I squeezed over to his table, sliding my backpack from my shoulders and myself into the chair. Yosh rolled his eyes.
"Oh, good. Company at the kids' table."
That's when I noticed he didn't have a folding chair of his own. He was sitting in a wheelchair. He didn't have a cast that I could see, so I guessed the reason was something more permanent. My tongue itched with the urge to ask, but I clamped my mouth shut. My mom said there was a fine line between healthy curiosity and invasiveness, but I wasn't always sure where it was. Besides, I reminded myself, I couldn't ask personal questions if I was hibernating. Mrs. Paradisi said, "I was just going over our plan for the fall. Class, as I was saying, we'll be approaching health and human development, or H&HD as we call it, from many angles. Nutrition and exercise, hygiene, drugs and alcohol, and mental health, not to mention friendships, dating, and sexuality." Titters rippled around the room at the last word. Mrs. Paradisi ignored them. "Basically, my job is to give you information and strategies to make smart choices so you can be the healthiest, happiest human you can be. See that poster with the three H's?" I followed her finger to a triangle with an H at each side. At the peak was a stick figure raising its arms in the stick figure version of triumph. "That's your formula for success," Mrs. Paradisi said. "Happy, healthy, human." She held up a package of index cards. "I'm going to pass out these cards, and I'd like each of you to write down something you'd like to learn in H&HD. This is anonymous, so ask anything. When you're finished, put your card in this box. I'll read out the questions, and we'll see where we should put extra emphasis this semester." I dug in my backpack for a pencil and stared at the blank card Mrs. Paradisi set in front of me. I knew what would make me a healthy, happy human, letting me go back to my old school where I knew my way around, where my teachers knew my name, all of it, where I had Becca. H&HD couldn't help with that. In fact, as far as I could tell, it would be a complete waste of time. I was one of the healthiest people I knew. I barely ever caught a cold, and I hadn't vomited since I was 3 on the spinning teacups at the county fair. Judging by the posters hanging around the room, the curriculum would boil down to eating vegetables, saying no to drugs, and getting a good night's sleep. Why did we need an entire class for that? Couldn't I take extra science instead? My pencil moved quickly. I wrote small so I could squeeze in everything I wanted to say, then folded my card in half. Stools screeched against the tile floor as the class scrambled up. I turned to the boy next to me, Yosh, and reached for his card. Here, I can take yours up. He snatched it back as my fingertips brushed the edge. Relax, I said. I wasn't going to peek. I just wanted to help.
Whatever, he said. Don't bother.
It's not any bother, I protested. But he was already wheeling through the mob. I watched, confused, then slowly followed and slipped my card through the slot in Mrs. Paradisi's shoebox. So much for being helpful. I was definitely better off hibernating. All right, class, Mrs. Paradisi said, clapping her hands for attention. Let's see what we've got. She gave the box a shake before removing the lid and drawing out the first card. What's the best way to pop a zit? She read. The room burst into giggles. Hey now, I told you to ask anything, and I meant it. We'll talk about skincare during our hygiene unit. She pulled out the next card. How to make girls like me. Well, nobody can force anyone to like them, but hopefully our unit on relationships will give you ideas on how to be a good friend and partner. Mrs. Paradisi continued to read questions. Most of them were pretty funny, or more accurately, they made people laugh. Sometimes the laughter seemed nervous, as if other kids were wondering the same thing, but were too embarrassed to ask themselves, which was irrational, in my opinion. The activity was anonymous, after all. I knew when Mrs. Paradisi had reached my question, because it took her a long time to read it. Her eyebrows knit. Eventually, she cleared her throat and read, Earthworms have been on Earth for hundreds of millions of years. They were here before the dinosaurs and will be here after humans become extinct. If anyone knows the formula for success, they do, and I bet they never had to take a class in earthworm development. So how come we have to take H and HD? There was an uneasy quiet as kids exchanged expressions of amusement and disbelief. Are they saying worms are smarter than we are? A kid whispered. Nah, they're just trying to get out of class.
Somebody wants detention,
another kid sang in a low voice. A girl whipped up her pencil and held it out to one of the boys like a microphone. Good morning, Mr. Worm. What's your secret for staying so fresh after millions of years?
Moisturizer, he answered. Lots and lots of moisturizer. Also, I poop 100 times a day, another kid said. It keeps me happy and healthy.
The room roared with laughter, except for Mrs. Paradisi and me. She was waiting out the hijinks, twiddling her thumbs. I, on the other hand, didn't see what was funny about my question. Didn't anyone appreciate what an achievement it was for a species to survive hundreds of millions of years when modern humans had only existed for 200,000? The way they were laughing, I bet no one knew, much less cared, that the mucus on worms' skin allowed them to breathe underground so that they could plow and fertilize the soil so plants could grow. To everyone else, worms were slimy and gross. End of story. That's when Yosh glanced over. Abruptly, he stopped laughing, and I realized how I must look with my flushed cheeks and pressed together lips. My stomach dropped as I imagined him pointing at me and saying, Hey, new girl's a worm lover. Which, honestly, wasn't that off base. Earthworms benefited the planet a lot more than humans. But I couldn't defend them without calling the entire class's attention to myself. Keep calm and hibernate. But to my surprise, Yosh said,
Hey, worms do valuable work when they're not getting washed up in rainstorms or used as bait. And everyone knows gummy worms are better than any of the other gummy species. Give them some credit.
The laughter grew scattered, uncertain.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.